They're gonna bust a verse on it. No, bust a verse.
Define soul or soul music, whatever you think is most appropriate in terms of your understanding of it as a creative person.
Well, soul music to me means really only two things. You say I'm cooking and now I'm drinking. And the rest of it, it's all like derivatives and distortions of it, I guess you would say. For you, factor in Curtis Mayfield. You know, the groups that came after that, Marvin Gaye, of course. Soul itself now has come to me. I guess the emotion that you put forth in the music that you make or you write, and it's been diluted a bit, I think, just because it's hard to get back to the purity of the R&B songs from the Al Green days and Sam Cooke days, you know, the early gospel music, when I say like from the quartets, you know, from the 40s and 50s, which is where Sam Cooke came from, and you can hear it in the music of Al Green. It's hard to get back to the purity of that, and we're a ways away from that, even I myself.
Do you feel that people can be soul, can they represent soul if they are not, like you are, a singer-songwriter?
Oh, certainly. Did you have somebody in mind in particular?
No, I just wonder if understanding that simplicity and being able to convey the message, if that is possible, if somebody isn't telling their own story.
I'm not sure. Sam Cooke did write his own material. I don't know. That's an interesting. I think it's difficult to be an artist if you're not expressing yourself. So I don't know.
Has a lot of ideas, it seems, about what the public wants. And in your experience, particularly with all the wonderful things that have been said about both of your albums at this point, do you sometimes have a hard time kind of navigating the artistic person that you want to display through your music versus what the industry or what the label tells you is the best thing for you to do in terms of being profitable?
No, not anymore. I think the label has conceded the victory to me as far as who we're going to be selling and what campaign I'm going to be supporting. They tried the Marvin Gaye thing, they tried the Curtis Mayfield thing on me. They've even tried the John Legend thing, if you will, where you bring an artist who is credible in his own right, but you put him with a rapper or some type of mainstream. That doesn't work for me either. I'm Van Hunt, whatever that means. I can't even tell you what all it means. I'm ever growing. but I do know what it does not mean. So I'm comfortable in that, and they realize that they need to take the lead from me. Whether they will or not, I mean, it's still up in the air. I hope so.
In terms of the comparison and how, you know, now you're being able to take the lead on determining, you know, your own style, your flavor, basically how you're presented to the world. Do you have any feelings personally about the term underground?
Yeah, I mean, when you say underground, I think of a world that is much like what you described. You said that your brand is about, if I can call it a brand, you know, the artists that are bubbling under, underneath the mainstream.
Do you think you fit into that?
Definitely. I think that everyone has to come out of that. Because if you're unknown, you know, you're unknown, but yet you've started the process, you know, you're underground. But I think that there are some artists who have become celebrated symbols of the underground. And I don't think that fit that. I don't even have those kinds of aims or goals, and I'm certainly not content with just being known to a loyal fan base, you know, small loyal fan base, even though I appreciate that to the utmost, you have to. But I want to be, you know, all over the place, because it's just in my nature to, you know, if I start to look at Van Hunt as a product, which, you know, honestly I do, that's separate from me now. So now I'm like, okay, well, we need to take this brand and do what we need to do as a business to make sure that, you know, as many people who feel like this is something that they want will be into it. So at this point, I want to be huge. As huge as it can be. I don't want people just getting a record and don't even like it. But I think that these are good songs that I've been given and blessed with, and I just want to share it with many people who I think will be into it.
On the edge. A lot of people, you know, have my last film was called No Such Thing as Neo Soul, and the conversation that was more of a localized look at how Philadelphia boomed and what were the factors that led to so many people from Philadelphia you know, entering into the market of being so well accepted. But there's a lot of flack about the term Neo Soul itself. Do you think that we are on the edge now, because Neo Soul has pretty much kind of played itself out at this point, just in terms of a term and everything else. But in terms of people like yourself, who are actually musicians, we had gotten away from that for a while. Do you think that now we're on the new wave of people who are taking more control of that creative process, both as singers, as songwriters, and, you know, as performers?
I'm going to say something, and I hope that it answers the question. I'm not sure it will. But it helped me when I began to look at everything as a product, including myself. When I did that, I was able to reconcile my artistry with, let's say, someone like a Jermaine Dupri, who puts out a product, but is a different product from what I do. It's definitely more entertainment than it is music. And I think he might even admit to that, you know. And once I thought about it, I was like, I'm comfortable with that. Because I know that I'm selling art and everyone else is selling something else. And that's okay. I just have to get on my game and to realize what it is that I'm selling and how to get it to people. Because I think that it's still viable and likable as anything else. I don't know if that answers the question or not. That's what came to mind when he was asking. Following me at night, how could she know? She's so real to him that I, even though we realized, how could she know?
Mention what you consider soul to be, but if you had to make like a musical care package, or I'll say a cultural care package, because maybe it's not just music, things that you think are essential for people to understand you or to reacquaint themselves with in terms of what we need in our lives, who would you put in that care package?
Musicians, singers,
whatever you think is essential, because that's gonna be different for everybody.
Things that I feel like people just need to enhance their cultural experience. I don't see how anybody can live without Thelonious Monk or Richard Pryor, or you know, people really need to get into gospel music, the gospel music of quartets like Pilgrim Jubilee, Jackson Southerlands, Dixie Hummingbirds. That music is so pure. That to me, I don't think anybody can live without that. I really don't. A little Bob Diddley and some blues, you know, a little Muddy Waters goes a long way too.
I'm actually glad you mentioned blues. and I swear I'm going to get out of your way. but I found that young people today don't know what R&B stands for. And often when I do educational workshops too around the creative writing process usually, or using hip hop as a teaching tool for any kind of subject matter. And when I ask kids what R&B means, they'll say rhythm and beats. They'll say rap and some B word. They, you know, I mean, because some B word, you know, they'll figure out something, but very few understand that R&B is, you know, a shortened version of rhythm and blues. What hasn't been passed down through the generations in terms of this cultural legacy that our kids are obviously missing because this music is not such an active part of their lives? Where was the disconnect, do you think?
I have no idea, honestly, because it was there from my parents to me, and it's there from me to my child. So I don't really know. I just think that, you know, people are followers, and that's okay. But it's all about who's leading, you know. And if they're not giving them the music and letting them know, you know, there's this alternative as well to Laffy Taffy, which is fine with me. It has its own place. But so does this, and so should this other music, is what I'm saying. And I have no doubt that if anybody was to sit down and listen to Slim and Supreme Angels or Swan Silver Tones, you're going to get into it as much as you would any R. Kelly track, you know. And nothing is more R&B than the other. I'm just saying, you're going to love it. Same way you would love anything else, because it's beautiful, it's pure, and it's true.